What's up, everybody? Welcome to another edition of the Trophy Talk Podcast. It's episode number 46, and today I am joined by Prince.
Hey there.
And Ace.
Hello.
So this is going to be the catch-up episode. It might be a little bit longer than usual because we've had some short ones because we've been rushing around like crazy. I've got extra trivia questions, and we've got polls and all sorts of fun stuff. But as is tradition, we are going to start with the news. So this has been pretty much the opposite of a slow news week. We've got a bunch of stuff that like has shown up over the past few days, and especially like in the past couple of hours, we've had some stuff pop up too. So taking it at the top, one of gaming's favorite franchises has finally revealed some information, not at E3, but at D23. So Kingdom Hearts is coming out in 2018. Sorry, to be clear, Kingdom Hearts 3, because God knows that they re-release enough stuff that it's probably worth being specific.
But I did hear that the Kingdom Hearts trilogy on the PS4 version is pretty good on Pro. Or was it on base? I can't remember. No, on Pro it was pretty good.
Hmm. I have no idea. I haven't ended up playing them. I ended up buying, was it the 1.5 remix when that came out for PS3, and then it just sat there because I'd already played it and I had new games to play. So,
and now it's redundant.
Yeah. I mean, I've beat 1 and 2, but you know, like, it's been 12 years since the second one came out, which means that it's been probably about 12 years since I've last played a major Kingdom Hearts game.
Mm.
But that's besides the point. It's coming in 2018, which is maybe a little bit sooner than, I don't know, maybe I would expect.
Yeah, that's what they're planning.
Right. It's actually funny. When I read the news, I was talking to somebody, and I was like, huh, Kingdom Hearts 3 is coming in 2018, which means that it's coming in 2019.
Although, in fairness, with the announcement of the Toy Story 3 world, they showed some gameplay of it in a video, and the gameplay looks like everything's there. Obviously, it's only part of it they're showing, but rather than the idea that it's still far off from anything, there is some substance, at least, to show.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, they I think it was at D23 they showed off a new trailer, and it showed off one of the new worlds, which is Toy Story 3. And so you get to interact with all of Andy's toys at Andy's house, I believe, and you're sort of miniature-sized.
Mm.
But they showed that off and showed some new transformations for the Keyblade. Mm. Apparently each version of the Keyblade is going to have two different modes, which, you know, the traditional, I guess, sort of Keyblade, but like one of them turned into a gun or something.
Oh.
Yeah, it looks pretty odd. But so they revealed that. They've also revealed that there's potentially a second playable character in the game. They were not entirely clear that it was necessarily going to be in the main game, but they
Riku.
Did sort of. Yeah, they also didn't say who it was. They were, like, very cagey about who it was. And that was kind of my reaction. I was like, well, it's probably going to be Riku. Well, so at first I was like, so Sora and Roxas, maybe?
Oh, yeah, that's like Kingdom Hearts 2. Sora and Roxas. Chain of Memories, Sora and Riku.
Yeah, so my first reaction was probably Sora and Roxas, but Riku would also be interesting.
Mm.
And the gummy ship will return, and they've also announced that the previously scarce, like, fourth tier of magic, so you've got your regular, like, Blizzard, and then there's Blizzara and Blizzaga. They've announced that the Blizzaza version, like the...
No, it's Blizzarcha. Don't mess it up, Square. You've been doing this for, like, 20 years.
I know, right? Maybe that's like the fifth tier or something. I don't know. But they said that Sora would now be able to access that stuff, which it has appeared before, but I don't think it's appeared in 1 or 2. It's been in the side games.
Mm-hmm.
So, realistically, all of that's fine and dandy, but the most important part is obviously that Kingdom Hearts 3 will be coming, or is planned to come in 2018, and Toy Story 3, because Toy Story 3.
And that's definitely going to be it. Surely going to be a lot sooner than Final Fantasy VII, which we haven't seen. So
Yeah, I mean, that's my assumption. So I was thinking like 2019 and 2021 or something, like, because it's just, well, they said that it was going to come out in the next, what's, how many years? They even said it. Not, don't expect Final Fantasy VII before 2020 anyways, right?
Oh. I thought their fates were tied in the faraway abyss of we'll
exactly.
see. But
exactly,
it's good,
and that's
that
kind of
Kingdom Hearts
how I thought of it. So, but yeah, so this is coming sooner, and then hopefully that means that Final Fantasy VII will end up coming out sooner, so that's good too. Also, interesting news, Telltale has announced all sorts of stuff. They just, like, started throwing information out at, I believe it was Comic-Con, San Diego Comic-Con.
Ah, good place for Telltale.
Yes, exactly. Especially because of the games that they announced. So, Walking Dead will get its final season and will have Clementine in it.
Yeah, it's the fourth and final season, isn't it?
Yeah, as somebody pointed out, there's a lot of "the" in the title because it's the Telltale's The Walking Dead: The Final Season or something like that. So that's coming eventually, but I don't think they said specifically when. Especially since season 3 just wrapped up. Batman season 2 will be coming, which is called, I believe, The Enemy Within, and the first episode, The Enigma, will come on August 8th. And then finally, which should make lots of people very happy, is The Wolf Among Us Season 2 is coming in 2018.
I downloaded it to my PS3 years ago, and I still haven't played it.
Yeah, so I've only finished the first 3 episodes of the first one because I was actually playing them as they were coming out, which obviously was a huge mistake.
That's
and
good
so
too.
I fell off in the gap between episodes 3 and 4, which is unfortunate because episode 3 was fantastic, but I got sidetracked playing other stuff and never got around to finishing that up.
I think with Telltale games, it's good if it's a 5-episode series, then around 3 or 4, hope that there's a sale, get in there, catch up on the 3, not too fast, then be on time for the 4th, if possible, and on the 5th one, definitely be on time. And that way, especially if you're really into the social media things like Twitter and whatever other ones light up with games. I don't know if Facebook talks much about games, but if you're there on the 5th one, then you can talk about it and the season as a whole at that point. And it's like you never miss the first 3. You can just talk about everything.
All right, and in a terrible segue, we're going to jump back to Square stuff because I didn't think to put this stuff together in the first place. So the Final Fantasy Dissidia NT beta has been announced and is up for registration. And along the same lines, Dragon Ball FighterZ, or Fighters, or however we're supposed to say it, is going to have a closed beta. The signups have not actually begun. That's going to be on July 26th. So if you're interested in those, you can sign up for them at their respective times. The Dissidia one is live now.
Do you think that people know what Dissidia FFNT is?
As in how many people or people in general? Because Dissidia has its following. Just for clarity, Dissidia, if you've not played a Dissidia game, is essentially a fighting game, right? But starring all sorts of characters from all across the Final Fantasy spectrum. So you've got all sorts. You've got your heroes and your villains and your, you know, everything. Everything's in there.
Yeah, you're a paragon. Now they know.
Yeah.
I was just wondering if I kind of had one of those moments where I thought, am I the only person who's played Dissidia? Because it was a bit niche, and I feel like
it is a bit niche. As much of a Final Fantasy fan as I am, I have not actually played it. So that does say quite a bit about how niche it is. I'm actually surprised that they're making, what, this is the third one, right?
Well, that's the thing. I think it's not a third one. I think it's, they haven't really progressed with the series, so I'm not sure if this is like a new one so much as it is a home console one, because the first two were on, I think both were on PSP. I didn't get any trophies in them, so definitely on PSP. And the second one included the first one, so basically the series is going from strength to strength. And now it's coming to a home console. It's going to look really good. And you've got all these characters. I think this one's even including new characters like Noctis. We might have to fact check that. The listener can fact check that. It's really good to fight with Final Fantasy characters from different games. But because it was on PSP, it's had a really limited audience. The beta is free. Good opportunity for anyone that has even a passing interest to give it a try.
Yeah, definitely. It's something I'll probably jump into. The last Final Fantasy fighter I played was, what was it, Ear Guys? I don't know if you remember that from like forever ago. It must have been in, 99, 2000.
Sorry, what was it called?
Ear Guys.
I don't think I know that.
So it was some weird, sort of, it had a fighter element and a questing element, and it was a very strange game. I'm trying to look it up because it's been literally that long since I've played it. But that was probably the last time that I played any kind of fighting anything with Final Fantasy characters.
I see. On the PS1.
Right. Did you manage to find it?
98 in Japan and 99 in America and 2000 in Europe, because back in those days, Europe gets bum last. So
yeah. So that was the last time that I played a Final Fantasy fighter of any kind. Anyways, sign up for those if you're interested. And while we're on the topic, the PS4 5.0 firmware beta registration is live, so you can sign up for that and check that out early. They have not said, as far as I'm aware, they have not said anything about what might potentially be coming in the 5.0 update.
I feel like they'll start to mention a few things, like when it's close to releasing, for the closed testing. That way they kind of mitigate the risk of people blabbing about it.
Not just blabbing about it, but you know, if there ends up something that has a massive problem, they don't want to have said that it's going to be in there, you know. So,
But it could be good. I mean, these have always been interesting, the major updates on PS4. They've made quite a few changes and additions, some of them more useful than others, but something to look forward to.
Especially since it's version 5, that seems quite big.
Yeah, a little bit momentous. Let us know which feature you think they should bring back from the PS3, because that's probably, at least there'll be one thing.
I want SingStar on the XMB. That's what I want.
Okay, carrying on. We've got some interesting industry news. The BioWare GM, who is the GM overseeing Anthem, has left, and BioWare star and Mass Effect leader Casey Hudson has taken over. Do we have any interest in that?
I tried to listen to someone talk about this, and then I got extremely bored. I do care about management, but ultimately, people are just saying names and numbers, and I care more about the numbers than the names, but I don't know what he has done, Casey Hudson, and I don't know exactly what is a general manager in a gaming company? Because if someone says the CEO has changed, then I understand, I'm on the same page, but what's the general manager?
You know, to be completely honest, I'm not entirely sure. Like, it's not something that gets thrown around a whole lot. So presumably, it's the person overseeing, I don't know, I think the entire studio. So I could be mistaken, but I would guess that this person oversees all of the projects that BioWare itself is doing.
Okay,
but it could be realistically anything. I mean, frequently titles in game companies can be a little bit fluid as to what each person is doing. But the important part is that Casey Hudson was the project director of the original Mass Effect, so
That was good, but it has changed a lot since then, and in many ways for the better.
Yes. Yeah, absolutely. That's not a... the series did grow and change and what have you, but that's probably what he's best known for.
So what has BioWare got going at the moment? As far as I can tell, it's Mass Effect, which is obviously not in a good place, and then Anthem, which is upcoming, and not a lot is known about it. Is there anything else going?
Well, I mean, that kind of depends on what you mean by Mass Effect, because Mass Effect is on indefinite hold, if I'm not mistaken. Right. So it's really just any ongoing content for the multiplayer, because they've also nixed single-player DLC for the game. Yeah, so that's not good.
Well, that's fine. They probably put a bunch of it as pre-order DLC anyway.
Yeah, so right now, all that we are aware of is Anthem, because that was their far-out game that they weren't really talking about, and now that the most recent Mass Effect was bumped, Anthem is the new thing that they're talking about, and I'm sure they probably have a couple of projects in the wings at this point that they're sort of sorting out, but we don't know what
it is. Yeah, it could be another Dragon Age on the way.
I mean, that's probably more than likely. I wouldn't be surprised. I think that the last Dragon Age was well-received and won some Game of the Year awards, I think, but I don't know how many people actually played it. I mean, if they need to get a bigger audience for it, and I don't know how they do that. I think it's just the very nature of the title has always been kind of threatening, I think, to mainstream audiences.
Yeah.
So,
well, a certain big TV show has three dragons.
Yes, and that's actually what I probably find most humorous about this, is that you'd think that in this day and age it would be way more popular, but I don't know. I feel like calling it, maybe it's the age part of the Dragon Age thing and not so much the dragon.
Dragon Young.
It feels
Mighty
like...
Go Young Dragon.
Yes, yeah. I guess maybe it just feels like it's too encompassing and, you know, it's just a little too dense for people to jump in on.
Make the box art three baby dragons and then a blonde lady who's not wearing very much, which honestly in Dragon Age is probably not that rare, so...
Yeah, actually, that's probably true. And then on the back, they can have the guy holding the gun and whatever. You know, make sure they hit their demographic.
Mm. Cool. Okay. Well, we've solved BioWare's problems.
Yeah. If you ever need any more help with marketing, please let us know. Okay. And finally, just a couple of small things to round up. Undertale has been dated for PS4 and Vita. It's coming on August 15th.
You guys know about Undertale? Have you heard?
Oh, sorry. So it was a very popular PC game.
Yeah. That's putting it fairly lightly.
Yeah. If I remember correctly, it's a pseudo sort of adventure RPG style game, but you don't have to kill anybody.
Well, right? It's very, very... meta, I guess you could say.
Yes.
Very, very satirical. And it's constantly aware of the RPG. It looks like a retro RPG. It's deliberately pixel art, but it's constantly aware of what those games were like. And I wouldn't...
Yes.
I'd say, like, if you think of Earthbound and how that was also quite self-aware in its time, this takes that to 100, because it's... like really quite cruel to the player in some ways, and it's very, very it goes off the deep end in its own ways, so that's definitely worth looking into if you like retro RPGs or RPGs that try something a bit different.
I've been meaning to play it, and so this will be a good excuse to play it. Now
I hope that the trophies aren't cruel.
I know that should be interesting. We'll see how that goes. But it was pretty critically lauded. A lot of people really liked it. So it'll be nice to have it on PlayStation, and we'll be able to try it out.
Finally.
Another not particularly well-known game, but critically lauded, GT Sport has been dated. So they have finally set down a solid date. It's going to come out on this date. It's going to be October 17th in North America and October 18th in Europe and Australia.
Guess the year.
Yeah, I know, right? Theoretically, it's coming out this year. But we'll see if that actually happens, because at this point, I'm quite skeptical about any racing game that Sony's trying to put out. Because this will be the second racing game, I think, that they said, oh, well, it's going to come out around this time frame, and have delayed it by at least a year.
Mm.
Right?
But in fairness, they've shown everything in regards to the physical options. They've got they've shown the cover art, which is quite rare for a release date announcement. They've shown the limited edition packaging, which includes a steelbook. So all of that stuff is already cemented and good to go. So I think probably they have been cautious and waited until everything is ready before making the announcement. So maybe it will come out.
As well they should be, because the last thing they want is for people to actually compare this to Drive Club, because that would be really unfortunate. Especially because, I mean, that's not fair really in any way, because GT has been around for so long. And it's always been, for the most part, very excellent. Very excellent.
And very delayed.
Yes. Well, yeah, and off delayed. I mean, that's just kind of part and parcel for GT. I find it a little bit interesting that for some reason it's coming to North America first. I mean, but who cares? It's a day.
But it's one day. I suppose it could come down to the release schedule timing. Sort of.
I'm sure it's something silly like that. Finally, Ni No Kuni 2 has been delayed into 2018, which is probably a good idea. There's just, so much stuff coming out this fall.
Did they say why it was delayed?
They gave the sort of typical company line of, we thought we needed just a little bit more time to deliver a phenomenal product, yada yada. One of those kind of deals. They weren't really specific about anything going wrong or anything in particular that they needed the time for or anything like that. They just kind of gave the, it's just going to be that much better,
Yeah. But in their defense, I'm sure it would be a huge 100-hour RPG, so there's plenty to work on.
Yeah, I mean, there's no doubt that they will actually use that time to refine it and make it just that much stronger. Mm. I mean, I'm sure if they've made it anywhere near the polish stage, that's just more time to polish it and make sure that it runs perfectly. So just that much better of a package when it finally comes out.
Great.
And I was actually lying. There is one more thing. Unfortunately, FIFA 14 servers are going to be shut down. And then I forgot to write down the date. When is the date?
2015? FIFA 14 servers shut down 2015. Would make sense.
Yeah, I guess. So it's shutting down on October 18th.
2017.
Yes, 2017. I almost said 2018 by accident because we've been talking about games lately and about 2018 so much, it just almost just came out.
Yeah, that would be a really early announcement.
Yeah, but anyways, so it's coming out, the server's going to stop October 18th, so it is worth making sure that you go ahead and polish off anything that you need to get done before then. Alrighty. So, from there, we are going to move on, and it is now time for popular trophies. And now I don't know where my special sound effect thing is. Oh, hold on, I got it. All right.
Okay.
Sorry, that was desperation. Behind the scenes, I messed something up, and it got moved around, and I literally, it's on my screen, but I lost it, and I couldn't find it.
No worries. All right. Welcome to Top of the Trophy Pops for July 19th, 2017. Not a huge surprise, the chart is still crashed this week, 3 weeks in a row, but there is signs of the old Bandicoot slipping, hopefully not down a big hole.
or into a giant rock, or...
Yeah.
Depends how many lives he has left.
But we do have a new leader this week. So something interesting there.
Hey.
And a lot of others have all slipped down by at least one position. So first you have to say goodbye to That's You and Don't Die, Mr. Robot. Not usually surprising, I suppose, that they slip away.
Yeah.
A PS Plus game for Mr. Robot, obviously. People had got what they need out of it and moved on.
Naturally.
So, we've got seven spots this week. At spot number seven, we've got Rocket League. Champions Field DLC that slipped down. Good times. It's at spot 27 with 227 wins. So
not bad.
Yeah, last week that was at the top with 868 wins. So it's all for all intents and purposes kind of slipped out, but it's just holding on by a pinky.
Yeah, it's interesting. It's something the Rocket League, it's holding on, and I think it's a testament to how many people are playing this, in that, you know, it keeps adding more people, and so even for like what is probably a relatively small DLC, you still bring back so many people that it still managed to stretch over 2 weeks for a DLC.
Yeah, it's certainly keeping in there with the next ones. Number six down in position is Game of Thrones, Telltale Series. It's at spot 23. Same trophy again through the night, 238 wins, whereas last time it was 496. But there are more other trophies in the charts. We've got 17 other trophies this week compared to only 4 other trophies last week. So
people are hitting this hard. They've moved through Don't Die, Mr. Robot, and whatever else, and are moving on to this.
Yeah. So it's slipping down, but it has quite a substantial appearance in the chart. So probably being a Telltale game, people, as you say, probably powering on through it, and it'll probably disappear along with the Rocket League.
Yep.
Which
well, they're doing it.
TV series started now, so.
Oh, that's true too. I didn't think about that. That makes sense now. That makes a lot of sense. Also, people get to do it the right way, which is they have the entire thing and they just play through it.
Yep. Which takes us to the first of the Bandicoots, or in the going up the chart anyway. At number 5, Crash Bandicoot Warped. It's at spot 22, down. Same trophy, taking the scenic route. 240 wins and 2 other trophies in the chart, which was 549 wins last week and 4 others. So it's kind of
slipping.
Halved a bit, kind of, sort of. Yeah, roughly.
Yeah, pretty much.
Okay. At number 4, we have, surprise, surprise, Crash Bandicoot 2, Cortex Strikes Back at spot 18, also down from last week. Same trophy, a road less travelled, 274 wins and 2 other trophies in the chart, compared to last week, which was 749 wins and 13 other trophies in the chart. So, considerable reduction there.
Yeah, back in your corner, Bandicoot.
Yeah, right. But it's still holding on because, you know, it's still taking up a crap ton of the list.
Yeah.
I mean, the Bandicoot himself, not necessarily each individual game.
Yeah, but I just think it's interesting that these trophies aren't moving on to like later trophies. It's still the same sort of beginning trophies, but there's not as much presence in the chart of like the following trophies. So there's people doing it, but not going as far. Don't know. It's interesting.
Well, so it seems like we're getting a fresh supply of people each week that end up getting it,
yeah,
which is strange. I wouldn't have expected that to happen.
I suppose it could be people that haven't got around to it. You know, they put it on their backlog and they had something else they're desperate to finish. So
I think sales are good because of the popularity and the sort of presence of the nostalgia, but at the same time a lot of these people aren't fully committed to it because they're not all that interested in getting there, and also the fact that I've heard that the games are notably very difficult, so I think a lot of people would get to a point where they've had enough and they're like annoyed enough with it and they're like, okay, I've had my fun and I'm not gonna complete it.
Well, and couple that with the fact that a lot of people playing it cannot power through it like they used to. Not only is it still quite hard and these people have gotten older, but they also have other responsibilities. Yeah. So instead of just playing and redoing the same thing over and over,
yeah,
people have things to do. Mm-hmm. They can't just do that, you know. So
Yeah. So, can you take a wild guess at what's at number three?
Sonic?
Nope.
No. So we've seen Crash Bandicoot 3, and we've seen Crash Bandicoot 2.
Yeah.
What could be next?
Time's up.
Crash kart racing.
No. No. Just plain old regular Crash Bandicoot at spot 15. Mm-hmm. Interestingly enough,
to the clan.
Yeah, interestingly enough, this one is actually a different trophy. It's Spin Doctor, 283 wins plus 8 other trophies. So, you know, compare that with the two of the other trophies from the other ones in the chart. It's still got quite a good showing there. So, people obviously still trying to work very much on the first game.
Yeah.
Not quite jumping ahead to the next ones. 283 wins, so that's... it's down from last week, which had 810 wins, and it had 16 other trophies in the chart. It was hogging quite a lot of the chart, the original Crash Bandicoot.
You know, it occurs to me that perhaps the reason why it's all early trophies on these is because people are jumping between the games, right? Some people started on 3, some started on 1, some started on 2, mm-hmm. and people are rotating.
Mm.
Yeah, it's
possible. You know,
could be.
Especially since if you did get to a point where you're stuck, then you could just swap to a different one.
Exactly. It's not.
Yeah.
Yep.
So, at number 2, we've got a re-entry. The Killing Floor 2 at spot 13. The Tragic Kingdom, 329 wins. No other trophies in the chart. Just this one that's snuck back in there. Now, looking at this one, I wonder if it's got anything to do with a solution post on TT by Sheik of Wisdom. It was a nice video one on there to how to get the trophy and achievement. But it is someone else's video. Unfortunately, I haven't looked to see which one that is. I should have done. Oh. Sorry about that.
Shout out.
Fail. Yeah, shout out fail.
Yeah.
Sorry. My computer is being silly. There we go. That is by Harry 94, I think that's right.
Oh,
yes.
Yeah, he's one of the most prolific trophy solution posters on YouTube.
There you go.
Been around for a while.
So I don't know if that spurred on a few extra people to knock this one out finally. I certainly couldn't see any suggestions about there being any problems with it, but maybe they were and I missed that. So there you go.
Yeah, it's interesting to see it re-enter.
Yeah. So that's definitely like a little trendy one slipping there.
Yeah, of all the things.
Quite a lot of trophies for just a single trophy. Quite a lot of wins for a single trophy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All right, which leads us at number 1. New entry this week. Final Fantasy.
Woo! Woo!
The Zodiac Age. At spot 1, trophy Assault Striker, 678 wins. Not a huge amount. We've seen more wins before.
Cold.
But there are 13 other trophies in the chart. So a good... It's between that and Game of Thrones for the battle over the amount of the top 50 chart.
Mm.
Yeah, that's a lot of trophies between the two of them. Yeah, I'm not surprised that ended up making it up onto the list. I mean, I imagine that... I don't know if it's going to stick around that long. It's quite an old game, but I imagine that eventually you get to a point where the trophies are of the you've spent 80 hours playing this game category, and that's going to probably stretch it a little bit so that it doesn't pop onto the list again. But
I've heard that it's a good quality... remaster. I'm not sure which one we're calling it, but I've heard that it's quite good with a few modifications, gameplay modifications, as well as a lot of visual modifications. Aside from the increased resolution, there's a lot of texture changes and so on, which makes it look a lot better, I've heard. Apparently it's not great. I mean, it's not really improved much on Pro. You're basically as good playing it on the base PS4, but
yeah,
I suppose that's fine. Maybe I'm biased.
Yep. Yeah, I've been interested in getting back to play it because people keep talking about it and some people are like, oh my god, it was such a great game and all you haters and whatever, whatever. And I'm like, I was totally one of those haters, and I have no idea what you're talking about. Maybe I just didn't appreciate it at the time.
Yeah.
And so, like, part of me really wants to go back and play it and just be like, see, you're wrong.
Don't go in with that mindset, because then it will definitely cement.
Right. I mean, that's biased, and I would not obviously do that. I would do it only because I want to actually enjoy the game the way other people have enjoyed it. But it is also a lot of time invested in that game. So I don't really see that happening. I just don't have time for it.
Well, aside from the very different gameplay of battles, the whole atmosphere, like the whole world of it, is completely different to any of the other main entries. So this whole Ivalis thing, it's the same as it's the same as the Tactics Advance, Final Fantasy Tactics Advance, and it's just like a really nice place to be in. So if you like that, it's just unique in the series.
Yeah,
it's definitely an interesting game. It's got a lot. It is a good game. It has a lot going for it. I had my issues with it back in the day, where I was just kind of like, really, this is not interesting, or that's not interesting. And, you know, so there are plenty of things to enjoy, especially the combat, which is a lot of it is very programmable. It's apparently automatic, but when you really get down into the nuts and bolts of how you can customize how your party members act, it's a fantastic system, and it's a lot of fun, you know, messing around with.
Yeah.
So if I were to play it, I did enjoy the game enough to replay it just so I can mess around with that system again, because it was a lot of fun to play with.
Reminds me of Transistor, now that I think about it.
Yeah, in that sort of way, but a lot more complex. All right. And that is it for trophies for us.
What do you think it's going to be next week? I mean, I know Super Hot is, I think it's out today in the UK, but it's two more days, isn't it, for the States?
That's got to
I've got that sitting on my console already. But I can't actually play it until Friday, so I'm a little bit disappointed about that.
Yeah.
But I've been literally been waiting to play this for forever. And I just never got around to playing it on PC. So, so we've got, is that this week's? Okay. So coming out this week, we have 99 Vidas, VIDAS, just for clarity, since this is a PlayStation podcast, Archangel, Children of Zodiacs.
Okay.
Conga Master, as in like a conga line. It looks like people dancing. I don't know. Conga Master. The dance floor fills. The line gets longer. Come on down. It's time to conga. it says absolutely nothing about what kind of game it is, other than fun arcade action. So
okay.
There is Fallen Legion, Flames of Rebellion, and Fallen Legion, Sins of an Empire. Flames of Rebellion is the PS Vita version, and then Sins of an Empire is the PS4 version. Apparently, they're supposed to be like sort of complementary stories, and they focus on the same story from different perspectives, but I've not actually played, so I have no idea how that actually works. Orcs Must Die Unchained, Robot Riot Hyper Edition, obviously Super Hot and Super Hot VR, which, for the record, the Super Hot VR, if you've already played the original Super Hot, the Super Hot VR is actually a different game. So it has all the same sort of general mechanics, but it's actually been built from the ground up for VR, because the way you interact with the world is slightly different, so how you approach things is different.
You know that Super Hot VR is going to be awesome.
Yeah, it's honestly, so you can buy Super Hot and Super Hot VR as like a bundle, I think. Mm-hmm. And I almost considered doing it so that one day I could play, you know, Super Hot VR too. But yeah. I was like, okay, you're buying a game that you're probably going to play for a couple of hours instead of something else. Hold off on buying the thing that you don't even know when you're possibly going to play it. And then Yonder, The Cloud Catcher Chronicles.
Yeah, I had my eye on that. I think it's like it looks to have turned out okay, but not excellent. So yeah.
I have no idea what it actually is.
The it's invoking a Zelda-like adventure.
Oh, interesting.
But on a much lower budget.
Hey, you know, if you can do it. But that's it. It's going to be kind of, you know, I don't really know what's going to take over. It's going to be super hot, and then, I don't know, maybe orcs must die?
Hmm. Are we including what comes out on Tuesday? No.
Well, I mean, there is the potential that something that comes out on Tuesday could hit the chart, but usually it's only if it's like a digital game, because very rarely do people... I mean, a trophy might make it onto the list. Why? Mm-hmm. What's coming out next Tuesday? Oh, is it Pyre? Pyre's coming out next Tuesday, right?
That's it.
Yeah, okay. Yeah, I almost forgot about that. I've actually got like several goals on TT right now because I want to finish up a few smaller indie games before Pyre comes out. Mm-hmm. Because Pyre for me is sort of marking the beginning of the fall, sort of.
Yeah.
Like, it's that, and then there's a couple games in August, and then September and October are fucking nuts. And then there's like nothing in November right now for some reason.
Mm.
But it's sort of kicking off the fall, so I'm trying to get
you don't need a game in November. You can just play Mario for the whole month. It's fine.
Well, you could play any number of games that are coming out this fall for quite some time. So yeah. But yeah, so Pyre might actually, you might be able to get a couple of trophies up on there.
Mm.
God knows 10% I'll be
playing pre-order discount with plus.
So I know I haven't played Super Hot with it, which I just bought, but I'm probably gonna have to go and pre-order that too.
Yeah.
So, I've got plenty of time to play these games. Don't give me that.
Yeah, it's not like we don't have day jobs. We don't have families to think about. It's
fine. Well, actually, right now my wife is working on her dissertation, whatever. So I hardly see her, anyways.
Oh, well, then quit your day job and you're set.
Yeah, there you go. I mean, she's gonna be bringing in the big bucks soon enough, anyways, right? I could just quit now and, you know, throw my chance to secure myself out the window, because it's totally going to work out.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Not for an indie game.
Yeah, yeah. And just to have enough time to play a couple of indie games. That's right. Dedication. Okay, so let's get into what we've been playing, because we've been playing a lot of stuff, but we have not actually talked about playing a lot of stuff. So Did you want to start off, Ace?
Yeah, let's see, not so much this week, a little bit more from the previous weeks, I guess. I kind of left over still doing some Lego Marvel's Avengers on PS3 and PS Vita, just trying to finish these ones up before, of course, the Lego Marvel Super Heroes 2 drops in November. Yeah.
There's a November game, there you go.
Yeah.
Ah, there we go. Ace has got a November game.
Yeah.
Superhero to the rescue.
Yeah, obviously I've played a bit of some games for the alphabet challenge that we finished before, so need to carry on with some of those a bit. Wipeout, Mega Collection, Final Fantasy 15, Infamous 2. I got all the trophies in the swapper, that was great, so didn't need to do that again. And to be honest, my mind was kind of a bit whacked from that game anyway.
Yeah.
Existential crisis engage.
Yeah, it's, if you haven't played it, the puzzles are actually fantastic.
Oh, they're great, yeah.
And I know we went over it last week a little bit, but the puzzles are actually really clever, and eventually they are literally all just like you're looking at this puzzle, and then something clicks and you're like, oh my god, I understand exactly how to do this. So they're all very clever puzzles for the most part, and then to go along with that, like the story is about like consciousness and all what is existence and can this thing do that? And it's all sorts of ridiculous stuff.
What is life?
Yeah. What is life? How do you define life? And can an inanimate object be alive? And yada yada. So
Yeah, it's really good. It starts off as kind of a bit weird, but once you just sort of accept where it is and where it's going, yeah, it's like, oh, okay. And you pick up bits. It's worth trying to read all the terminals and all the little pop-up bits. So there's quite a bit of reading in the game to get the full backstory, but then there's also audio messages and things as well. So it's a nice balance. What I really, really like about the puzzles is they're not frustrating. They don't punish you for getting it wrong. You can if you mess it up, and you will mess it up, then you literally only have to walk like a few feet just to get back to the starting position and have another go. It's none of this. You die and then you have to go right the way back to the beginning and get all the way through the level again. Anything like that in any other game that drives you mad. It is really easy going. The only thing I'd say is the atmosphere was a bit creepy. Now,
Oh, yeah.
because I was playing this for the alphabet challenge, I actually stayed up all night playing it, so that didn't help. So
Oh, yeah.
late at night or
Well, that's.
early in the morning, when your mind is already starting to sort of, you need to be asleep and start to play tricks and things on you to be playing that kind of game.
Yeah.
It was.
Well, and yeah, so it's atmosphere and like the music, and there's just this one sound where you just hear it and you're like, ooh. Because so you the premise is you can make clones or whatever, and when they die you can make more clones. And so very frequently clones fall off ledges or whatever, and you hear them hit the ground and crumble, and then you hear their spacesuits start to leak air, and it's like hissing out, and you're like, oh God. It's fantastic. I mean, it's a little bit horrifying, but it's fantastic.
Yeah. Yeah, I really enjoyed that one. So that's the kind of thing I can really get into. Once I sort of got over the slight, yeah, the creepy atmosphere, because I think I said before I need to get back to Resident Evil 5, but I have this sort of anxiousness about these sort of games until I've played it for a bit and then like, ah, oh, yeah, I'm fine. I'm back to normal again. Yeah, just
Yeah,
not playing it or
busy
not familiar
five
with it.
VR.
No, don't talk about that one again.
SE5
Do you know
VR.
that was hard enough watching someone else play it, and the amount of meme videos where they show it coming across the first scuttling thing at them, and then they're just sort of going pause, quit. Not be me. Oh, dear. But yeah, no, so that was really good. I enjoyed that one. That was a unique experience, which without the alphabet challenge, I would not have gone out to find and do. So that was really good. And the Lego, I think you probably notice a pattern here with like the Swapper and Lego. I like very sort of,
Platformers?
well, platformers, yeah, but I was going to say,
You like existential games.
well, I was going to say very sort of rudimentary, sort
Meta.
of, you know what to do, go and collect this, go and do that, you know. I wouldn't say easy, because I mean there's quite a lot of time involved and some bits can be tricky, but yeah, I suppose it for me gaming a lot of the time is to relax and chill out, not
Certainly.
hard competitive rah, and all the rest of it. So yeah, take Super Hot for example. I want to find out, is that hard or is it kind of relax? I mean, is it quite easy? Because then I'll probably find it quite relaxing doing all the shooting and the blasting. But if it's you die a lot because if you get hit by one bullet, you're done for. Then that might be a bit frustrating for me.
You die a lot, but it's quick respawns. It's part of the gameplay.
And I mean, obviously, when you're not moving, time slows down. It does get to a point, I think, where it's like, it can be a lot going on, so you have to learn how to process it. So it's very much about being aware. I don't know if that part would necessarily be relaxing. But I kind of agree, and I sort of understand. Like, I tend to like open world games for that purpose. Like, I don't play. I'm not huge on open world games that are super involved. Horizon is maybe a little bit of a different story, but I tend to like open world games because you spend it's kind of relaxing. You get in a rhythm and whatever, and it's not too stressful at any point. So I'm very much like that, especially like collectathon type games. It's just so relaxing.
I like them when there's no pressure of missables. So in an open world game, if you're worrying about going into a new area, and then if you pick up 10 of this, and then that means that later on when you do, when you have to follow a video walkthrough of the whole 100, and then you're like missing 10 and you don't know which ones you've got and which ones you haven't got, that's a nightmare. But if they have in-game maps, 100% perfect. Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah. For that aspect, not I mean the overall rating.
Yeah, absolutely. So speaking of collecting stuff, I've been playing Valiant Hearts, which, hey. So I played the first like two and a half chapters. So I had like a chapter and a half to go. And so I jumped back into that and finished that and started collecting all of the various little, they are collectibles, but they're historical items. And yeah. So like you pick them up and it's like, well, this was standard issue for the Canadian Army and yada yada and all sorts of stuff like that. And it's really kind of interestingly informative.
It's infotainment.
Yeah. It's a remarkable game for any number of reasons. It does have its shortcomings, and most of those shortcomings are really the gameplay. But everything else around that is pretty fantastic. It manages to, you know, sort of convey the darkness and grimness of the scenario and what was happening to people without being like berating you with it. It does sort of break up the very grim scenes with every now and then you have like a car chase scene where you're throwing TNT backwards and blowing crap up, and it plays like fun classical music during that, and then like
you slice of the bumblebees in that scene.
Yeah, that was fantastic. And it, you know, the enemies like throwing barrels at you in time with the music and stuff. So I think it manages to convey some very dark things without going too far to make it unbearable. But it does a remarkable job of conveying the desperation and how awful it was. In some small part.
I think it's a fantastic game, actually. It really struck me when I played it. What did you use to get the collectibles? Did you just poke around? Or?
I tried to poke around, and then I used a guide to clean up.
Ah, okay. Which guide did you use? I'm just going to give a heads up to any listeners. If you're looking for the collectibles on Valiant Hearts, there's a walkthrough on True Trophies, and the quality of it is very high. So,
yeah, you say this in a completely unbiased fashion.
Well,
it is top notch.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so definitely go and check that out by some mystery author.
Well, it has 11 thanks. So,
not bad. Yeah, and it is a good idea. Like, there, if you can save yourself the time, I don't think you need to do what I did and go back and collect stuff. I'm sure it's written well enough that it's not going to give away solutions or whatever, and so you can definitely play through the game and just follow along with the collectible guide just to make sure you don't miss anything. Because I don't know that you necessarily have to go back. That's a little bit much.
It has the highest number of thanks, the second highest number of thanks of any walkthrough on the site. So I think that stands for itself.
That says a lot. Yep.
That's it.
So I also went back and finished Flower. So both Valiant Hearts and Flower were games that I ended up, I think Flower I bean dived at one point, but I also got a couple of trophies in the Alphabet Challenge, so I figured I'd finish that off. And then same thing with Valiant Hearts. I ended up going back to it because of the Alphabet Challenge, and so I finished that off too.
Flower is a good game also, definitely.
Yeah, it's a very, very good game. And, you know, I think it's the best credit scene in a game. It's just a very thematically appropriate.
Also, the atmosphere of it is just so refreshing.
Yeah.
Like, almost literally.
Yeah. I mean, thematically, it fits very well. And the music is pretty fantastic. It doesn't have a lot going on. There aren't really any, like, people or anything. Like, but there's plenty of emotion in the game despite that. You know, despite sort of the simplicity, I think, of what it's actually showing you. So I would definitely recommend that. It is fantastic.
And for reference, this is the precursor to Journey. So if you like Journey, then...
Yeah, that's just what I was going to say. Unsurprisingly, considering that they went from this and ended up making Journey. It is in some way sort of very much a spiritual predecessor to Journey.
Yeah,
it does cover slightly different themes, but some of the themes are the same, and it does have that sort of flowiness, and a lot of what's going on is you just absorb from the sound and scenes around you as you're moving, and moving is fantastic, even if I'm not a huge fan of motion controls.
But because of the way that it's a completely different setting, I think it still stands up even if you play Journey first and you go
absolutely
back.
Yeah, I've played Journey several times, and this was the first time that I really went through and played Flower. And I would absolutely recommend, even if you've played Journey, go and play Flower, because it is absolutely different enough and enjoyable in its own way. I finished Horizon on Ultra Difficulty. So that was fun.
Tell us how difficult it was.
It did get to be kind of difficult, but I still kind of breezed through it. It was like I did end up meeting much more resistance later on. I think when the enemies had sort of caught up with my equipment, and I did not, but it only got so hard because I did not upgrade my equipment at any point. I basically just stuck with the same equipment, and I didn't find mods and upgrade things for the most part. I didn't get the next tier up of gear. Though I don't know that it actually makes that much of a difference because the base stats are the same. So like the next tier up has all the same stats as the current, you know, the previous max tier. But you just get an extra mod slot. So it doesn't change it dramatically. But I never actually ended up getting any of that stuff because it just wasn't worth the time to go and collect everything. I still plowed through the game pretty easily. It is hard enough, and the enemies are, you know, improved enough that you have to be smarter when engaging. Like if you try and just do what you did last time, you probably get taken down pretty easy unless you figured out literally everything in the game. It would take too long and you'd get worn down over time. But if you play a little bit smarter, you'll figure out how to expose more weaknesses and things like that, or, better ways of dealing with things. So definitely. Yeah. So it does encourage you to be a little bit smarter about how you play. But in the end, I did still pretty much like the entire last battle. I think I only died once, and it's a rather lengthy section.
Well, it's a relief that it's not a nightmare, I suppose.
Yeah, no, it's a fun. It's definitely harder, but it's a fun hard. It doesn't cross over into a frustrating realm. So that's good. And then finally, Destiny demo. I played that. I played through the story and I played through the strike. It is definitely improved. It's a lot of small improvements, though it's a lot of improvements where you're like, oh, that makes sense. But nothing that you're just like, oh man, that is a huge improvement. Again, I think it's going to be kind of more of the same. It's going to be a bigger jump than it has been for the expansions, I think, because for instance, the story is much better and how that factors in. And like in the first mission, I came across several like hero characters that actually interacted with me, and story stuff happened in the game. It didn't like cut to a cutscene. So all of that is much better. But as for actual gameplay improvements, it's small things like new enemy types that change things up a little bit, and sort of smarter indicators like snipers. You can sort of hear the whine of their weapon before they shoot at you, so it kind of tips you off and you're not just randomly dead every now and then. So but it's a lot of stuff like that where a new enemy type that's not drastically new, it's a melee type of enemy that just looks a little bit different and shaped like a dog, and you know, so that's not really that drastic. So
I'm a little bit concerned. As much as I'm sure that the story will be interesting, I'm a little bit concerned that the general glow about the gameplay is a little bit of a ruse, because ultimately it comes down to how well it does as like a loot game.
Yeah.
And if it's as toxic as it was before, then it won't be any better now. It'll still be bad. But the thing is that Destiny is brilliant for the first, I don't know, 20 hours or whatever. And then after that is when it becomes really, really toxic. So playing like betas of Destiny, you're going to experience all the best parts.
Exactly. And that's what I would definitely say is, like, for instance, like I said, plenty of story stuff. Eventually you get to a point where you're replaying missions or whatever, and none of that matters. So, you know, this is not really all that informative. It does, at the very least, address the fact that the story was a little bit lackluster. So that's good. But, you know, eventually that stuff doesn't matter. And realistically, it doesn't give you much loot to start off with. It gives you everybody like the same set of weapons, so you can mess around with the various types of weapons. And I think I picked up one exotic weapon at one point, and then other than that, when I finished the strike, I got two pieces of gear, and that was it. So aside from rerunning the gear, the strike over and over, I'm not really going to see much, and it didn't look like the gear that I did get really did anything of substance. It does look like they may have streamlined some things, but it's hard to tell. Like, I didn't interact with enough different things. So we'll see. Like, it could be better with the story. I don't see much difference in terms of gameplay necessarily just yet. The strike did have quite a bit of variety to it, which was nice. But again, we'll see. This is just a very, very small chunk of the game.
Yeah. I hope it turns out well.
And I've been talking quite a bit, but I've got one more game. I've been playing Mr. Shifty, which is pretty fantastic, which is the Nightcrawler thief game where you are this guy who can teleport around and punch people really hard. And it's sort of a cross between Nightcrawler and Hotline Miami, except it's a little bit faster, a little bit more forgiving, and it's much more game. It does do that sort of action balanced with puzzle sort of, where it's like you have to figure out the best way of handling a thing, but it does like have a lot more, I don't know, beat 'em up vibe to it, where it's a lot more about running around and punching stuff than it is that sort of puzzle element. You do still have those where you get to a situation where it's like, okay, you've got all these people. How are you going to take them out in the best way possible? And it's like, it's about getting them to, you know, shoot at each other or whatever, but, or, you know, how you're going to zip between rooms and things like that. But you also definitely get sections where it's like, you're fighting off wave after wave after wave of enemy. And so it is a little bit more twitchy in that regard, and it's much more, I don't know, fast and physical.
Yeah.
And that's a nice change to most of the normal levels, but in those sort of wave after wave scenarios, they start out slow and they take a little while to get going before there's any real challenge, and they kind of can take up a lot of time. So we'll see how it plays out. I've only played through the first, 8 or 9 stages. I get the impression that there's probably about 30 stages, so that could clear up when there's more complex enemy encounters. But for now, at the very least, most of the game is fun and fast and frenetic.
This is 2D side-scrolling, right?
Top-down.
Top-down. Oh, yes. like Hotline Miami in that sense. Okay.
Yeah, very much. It's very much that you don't pick up any guns, but you can throw a lot of different items that you pick up, like brooms and stuff like that. And they sort of augment. So you're already very capable at just like punching stuff. Like the first time I punched somebody, it literally hit them so hard that they went flying out the window and like fell to their death. Sometimes you literally hit people and they go flying through like a statue and then through a wall. So you're already hitting people really hard. And that kind of stuff it's kind of enjoyable. Like, it is really satisfying. It's got a very like sort of superhero-esque feel to that. Like,
is that the wall punch or just a regular punch?
So it's really just a punch. There's no like warp punch. I think they are of the mind that you are using your ability and somehow to augment how hard you're hitting people, but they never actually go over that. So
I was thinking of the Vanguard in Mass Effect 3 that would just warp and hit into people.
Yeah, no. So I presumably, you know, there is some level of like manipulation of teleporting or something that's causing you to hit so hard. I don't really know where it comes from, but you hit really hard and you can teleport all over the place, and you can teleport quite frequently. But they've started introducing like restrictions on where you can teleport and where you can't, and, you know, thick walls and stuff like that. It's a very kind of cheeky, self-aware game. Like, at one point, the villain was like, "I figured out your weakness. It's walls that are 10 feet thick." You know, like, it's got a very cheeky, sort of cheesy thing going on. It's enjoyable. Yeah. I would definitely, so far, I would definitely recommend it. It does have some drawbacks, but it is very fun to just, like, sort of play and breeze through it. In some ways, if anything, it's a little bit too easy. But it is a good game. All right. So that's been Brandon talking about video games for a really long time. did you have anything to add? I think you've been kind of busy with other stuff, unfortunately.
I've played about an hour of a game, so it's literally not worth mentioning. If I finish it, then I'll talk about it. But yeah.
Yeah. So as you can figure out, we are kind of old farts in some ways. And
speak for yourself.
We've got responsibilities, some of us.
He's joining me in throwing him under the bus.
Yeah. anyways, that's besides the point. We will move on to, it is time for trivia, which, sorry we haven't had a whole lot of time to get into trivia. We've been obviously rushing because we've had commitments and things. As we just mentioned. I did have enough time to sit down and come up with some trivia, and so I've got some extra questions so we can make up for last time. Are you ready for trivia?
Yes.
No.
No, not at all. Okay, so these trivia questions are... So I went back and I looked at what we were talking about at the time, and so these do actually sort of follow along with, you know, the trivia that we have skipped. So we can sort of actually make up for it. But we're going to work in reverse order because there is a bonus to one of the questions.
Oh, boy.
And I want to, you know, leave that for last. Mm-hmm. So, starting with this episode's trivia question, like the famed Doctors of BioWare, Casey Hudson also has a non-game development degree. What is it? Is it biochemistry, astrophysics, mechanical engineering, or applied mathematics? Apparently, both of you are going to be guessing about this one, because...
I didn't even know who this guy was before today, so...
Yeah. So, either...
The others seem a bit...
I have...
You go ahead.
Well, I was going to say I have literally zero idea, so I'm just going to go for applied mathematics, because it's... the most dull, and not that I'm saying it's dull, but it would be the best. If it's true, it would be the best.
Yourself there. What were the others?
So, biochemistry, astrophysics, mechanical engineering, and applied mathematics.
Yeah, they're a bit kind of specialist, aren't they? Really, to end up then doing games, isn't it? Whereas
those are not casual degrees.
Yeah. Whereas they always say, you know, if you go into games, mathematics, make sure you've got that under your belt for the coding and logic and everything, so be really surprised if he's got a degree in biochemistry and makes games.
He just did it in his spare time. Just
could be.
A spare time degree in astrophysics.
Could be. Yeah, I'd say maths as well, because the others seem a bit unlikely.
Yeah.
So you're going with maths as well?
We're both wrong, are we?
You are, yeah. It's a mechanical.
Oh, it was that one.
I thought my chances were quite high of being wrong. So.
Yeah. Unfortunately, but you were talking about like biochemistry. If I'm not mistaken, one of the founders of BioWare was actually like, so they were actually doctors, like medical doctors. Okay. And I think at least one of them was a biochemist. So
and then they made
on those completely different studies.
I'm sorry.
I don't imagine that you'd get a doctorate from biochemistry unless you did a doctorate in biochemistry.
Well, no. I mean, but medical doctors, like medicine, from what I understand.
But so, does medicine lead into biochemistry, or is biochemistry an unrelated degree? I don't know.
Biochemistry is a very common, so at least in the United States, I believe, biochemistry is a fairly popular undergraduate degree to get if you're going to, if you're aiming for medical school.
So, yeah, that I can, yeah.
Yeah. Okay, so we're moving back an episode. Last episode, we were discussing, obviously, Horizon Zero Dawn got the patch, it got the Ultra Mode, and the New Game Plus.
Ultra!
Yep. New Game Plus is a fairly common feature in modern games. Which game coined the term?
Ah. Oh, boy.
Is it Chrono Trigger, The Legend of Zelda, Shin Megami Tensei, or Ghosts and Goblins?
Oh, it's so bad if I don't know this. In fact, I don't know this, but it's so bad if I get this wrong.
I think...
Right, because how many games, especially you, because how many games...
I think I owned all of those. Actually, I never owned Chrono Trigger, but obviously I should know Chrono Trigger.
Right.
What was the last one?
Ghosts and Goblins.
That sounds like the oldest one, doesn't it?
Well, the series is like Mega Drive days, but it's really confusing, the naming convention, because there's like three of them with a similar name.
Did Zelda start New Game Plus? I don't think so.
Sorry.
I'll throw something in. I'll say it openly, which might help Ace, but I'm going to say it anyway. I feel like with Zelda, because you've got that Master Quest scenario, I don't think they would have started with New Game Plus. I don't know how far back we're going, but I don't think there was. Because Master Quest obviously comes from Ocarina of Time days. Or maybe only the remaster of Ocarina had that, but I feel like, yeah, that's not Zelda in my mind.
No, so what were the other two?
So it was Chrono Trigger, The Legend of Zelda, Shin Megami Tensei, and Ghosts and Goblins. For those not in the know, the Shin Megami Tensei series is... It's referred to that generally in the West anyways, but it's basically tied to Persona. Right. It's sort of all in the same universe,
okay,
or what have you.
So I'm just going to go at this with gut feeling. Zelda, I don't think it's ever done New Game Plus, let alone started it. I think, was it Ghouls and Ghosts? Ghosts and Goblins. I can't even remember the name.
Ghouls and Ghosts
sounds too old to even have ever thought of that. One of them, I can't remember it or pronounce it, so I'm going to skip that one. So that leaves only one left, which is Chrono Trigger. So I'm going to go with that. That's my logic for today.
In the Mega Drive days, they didn't really have much in the way of saves, so you wouldn't exactly know the system.
Yeah.
New Game Plus.
Experience. Although it probably turns out that Ghouls and Ghosts came out last year or something.
Yeah.
Well, I don't know which part in the series, yeah. But, if you're going to go for Chrono Trigger, which actually I think could very well be it, because they had that whole legacy of the time travel and the elaborate story and whatnot. But I'm going to have to go with Shin Megami Tensei, because it's a big RPG, and New Game Plus is fairly prevalent in modern RPGs.
I'm glad you did, because I can't say that. Was it Shin Megami Tensei? What?
Shin Megami.
Yeah, that one.
I think it means New World Order, is it? I can't remember now.
Shimi Yurigami, what?
Isn't Shin Dragon or something? I don't know. Anyways, so Ace is right. It is Chrono Trigger.
That was lucky.
So,
logic works.
I was completely wrong on the presentation, by the way. Just, I'm going to admit that immediately. Completely wrong.
What did you say?
I was completely wrong on the translation. I'm going to admit to it immediately.
Okay.
So just for clarity, the Master Quest has existed, if I'm not mistaken, since the very original Legend of Zelda.
It's called Master Quest, right?
I believe it was called the Master Quest, yeah.
There you go.
So it does go as far back as the original Legend of Zelda.
Wasn't that the Master Sword Quest, or am I getting my masters confused?
I think you're thinking of the new DLC.
Right, okay.
Yes, you're thinking of the new DLC. No, this the Master Quest has been a tradition in Zelda for a long time, whereby basically you end up using a similar or same sort of overworld map, and things get remixed. So in some instances, the dungeons are slightly remixed, or the items are, you know, the placing of the items is changed, and so you have to go about things in a different order. Mm-hmm. And it usually it's interesting how much it messes up sort of your rhythm when you know a game so well, as you tend to learn a Zelda game over playing it for so long. It's interesting that they do that, and it usually is harder.
Do they have that in Ocarina of Time, or maybe I just can't remember? It was so long ago. Played it.
So it did not come out on the original cart in the West, I don't believe. But it did come out in Japan, and eventually they ended up re-releasing, I believe it was Ocarina and Majora's Mask on GameCube on a disc, and that had the Master Quest for Ocarina of Time on it.
I suppose I missed that one then.
Yeah. Yep. And then Ghosts and Goblins. I don't know if I might be mixing up with Ghouls and Ghosts, or but if I'm not mistaken, they had a, like, when you beat the game, they basically told you to play the game again. So in a way, it's sort of a new game plus, but it's really not. Basically, you're just playing the game.
Yeah, it doesn't
again.
Count.
but you have to literally play the game from beginning to end twice in a row to actually get the end of the game. There's nothing different. It's literally,
well, there's nothing different. Why do it? There's not like a different ending or anything.
I know, right?
Just okay. Now you've done it twice. Now you finish the game. What?
but literally the first time you get to the end of the game, and it's like, hey, all right, you beat the game. Actually, no, you didn't. Go back and play it again. Like, that's actually the first ending of the game. So it's like some games that require you to play through the game twice to get the true ending. They basically did that way back in the day, except they didn't change the game. They just changed the ending and made you play the game again.
That's just me.
It's absurd. Yeah, it's kind of absurd.
I thought it would have been the other one that I couldn't pronounce, because that's obviously... Shimi Tensei, whatever. Because I thought that's obviously the Japanese game. I thought, wow, I'm pretty sure they're the ones that started the whole plus thing. Well, at least I thought they were.
Japanese? What made you think it's Japanese?
So it had some kind of thing going on with New Game Plus stuff. I don't know what it was doing. But it started as far back as, I think, the first game in the series, which is well before any of the games were called Shin Megami Tensei. It was well before that. They had some kind of thing going on, but they hadn't named it. Or it was not called New Game Plus. I'm not entirely sure. But I do know that it was officially sort of coined New Game Plus by Chrono Trigger.
Mind you, if you put Resident Evil 5 on that list, I'd have probably gone for that.
Yeah, I know, right?
Resident Evil 5.
Or Resident Evil, four.
All right, and then finally, the episode before that, we were talking about Arkane Studios and how they had sort of mixed things up at the studio and some guy was leaving and what have you. Arkane Studios has not always been as high profile as it is today. What game did they help make? Was it Perfect Dark Zero, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, Eternal Darkness, Sanity's Requiem, or Call of Duty World at War?
Ooh. This is too difficult. you know when they have like game shows on TV and the answers are really obvious and everyone in the room is shouting out the answer at the TV?
Yeah.
And the people on the screen have no idea what's going on. That's how I feel.
So what were the games again?
So the games are Perfect Dark Zero, Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic, Eternal Darkness Sanity's Requiem, or Call of Duty World at War.
So
part of the problem when I'm making these trivia questions is that either I have to find something I didn't know, and use that as trivia, or I have to use something I already did know. And if I choose that, because Prince and I share so much gaming history and game industry knowledge, the odds are that he'd have a huge advantage. So,
thank you.
So that's part of the reason why this is so tough. Yeah.
Okay. Did you want
to go first? But just for the record, for all the listeners, he's an old man compared to me. So.
Oh, thanks.
Not you guys. You can pretend you're as young too.
Oh, right, okay.
Yeah.
You're anonymous. You can pretend to be whatever age you like.
I'm ageless. I'm all ages. Perfect Dark was Rare, wasn't it? I don't remember them having any help with that. Yes. So definitely, I know that game. So I don't think it's that.
Well, I think they would get help, but it was probably pretty Rare.
God. Oh.
You like that one, you know.
Just so people know, Ace is like super sleep deprived right now. So
you don't take away from my joke.
Oh, that was rubbish. I still didn't. Brennan, what was the other game?
So, Perfect Dark Zero, Knights of the Old Republic, or World at War?
I'll go with Knights of the.
Cross out World at War and flip a coin and go for it. You're not going to gain any more information thinking about it.
No. Knights of the Old Republic, that's kind of like an online morph one, isn't it? No?
Sorry. I'm gonna stay out of this.
Or perhaps not. I thought that was like an online one, that one, so it's quite big, so maybe they got a bit of help with some of that. I don't know. I'm trying to logically think this one out. Arcane Studios. I can't think what they've done. Yeah, I'll maybe go with.
It was an RPG on the Xbox and PC.
Oh, that's right. Yeah, so it wasn't the MMORPG then. It was just a regular RPG.
No, I also get those confused.
Yeah. I think that the Knights of the Old Republic one. Yeah.
With that. It was Call of Duty.
Oh, it was.
Bloody hell.
Really?
Yep.
You're a trickster.
I am quite the trickster.
You led us on so long.
Yeah. So I was going to answer that. Yeah, you're right. Knights of the Old Republic released on the original Xbox eventually, as did Knights of the Old Republic 2.
Oh, so. I'm surprised because I didn't think Activision. Actually, no, they're the publisher. The developer.
I think that might have been.
It was BioWare.
BioWare? What are you talking about? Call of Duty?
Yeah, man. Oh, I thought you were talking about Knights.
No. No.
Call of Duty World at War was made by the second team, so Treyarch,
however you pronounce it.
Yeah, back in the day when they were the B team.
Yeah.
Yep. Okay, so
they got help. Interesting. And yet it was still pretty buggy. Yeah. I'm afraid to play that one because of like glitched lobbies and things and all that.
Maybe that's part of the reason why. You know, I don't know Arcane Studios' status at the time. It might have been an independent studio, so it was like Activision getting outside help or whatever. But
come on then. Well, hang on. If that's the answer, you've got to prove it then. So what did they help them with it for then? Or you just got to take your word for it?
I don't question the question mark.
I don't
what you just what? Get out of the crystal maze.
Anyways, so bonus question. What other semi-famed game did they help out on? And I'll give you a hint. The reason why it was not why I didn't use that game is because if I had, it would have been pretty obvious what the answer was.
So now it's the tiebreaker question. It's pretty obvious.
The makers of Dishonored, are we?
They are most famous recently for Dishonored and.
I was going to say Prey, but I thought Bethesda was that one.
Deus Ex? I don't know.
Well, Bethesda's.
Oh, damn it. Yeah, okay. Publish it, yeah.
Well, it wasn't Deus Ex.
No. Okay.
Well, we have nothing to go off here, so.
Just you can throw something out there, or I can just give you the answer.
Hey? Like.
Prey the original.
It was not the original Prey. No.
Oh, we're still guessing. I thought it was. I thought it was Dishonored. No.
They made Dishonored.
They made.
Right.
Dishonored.
What's the question? I am really sleep deprived.
Okay. Yeah. Now we know. Don't let an episode go this long when Ace is tired.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay, you want
no, no, what was the question?
Okay, so what other semi-famed game did they help out
okay.
on? They assisted on this game.
Okay. And what is it?
Ocarina of Time.
Do you want to know?
Oh, I thought we normally yeah. pick from an answer. No, okay.
Ace!
Just yeah, pick a game. Oh, Metal Gear Solid. just guess a game.
No, no. It's not.
GoldenEye.
No. Bioshock.
Well, it's pretty lame if it's none of those. So.
Can't think of anything. Obviously, like they like shooters then, by the sounds of things, isn't it?
I'll let it go there, and I'll give Ace half a point. It was Bioshock.
Ooh.
2.
Half a point for what?
Oh, I got Bioshock.
Well, you got Bioshock.
Consolation point.
Yeah. But yeah, if I'd given you this list instead of Call of Duty, I put in Bioshock 2, I think that would have been kind of an easy answer.
Mm.
Maybe. All right. So, okay. So anyways, we'll move on, and we're just going to real quick go over the poll results from last week.
Ooh, yeah.
And I totally picked the wrong episode. So the poll last week was how old is too old to be playing games?
Yes.
And I made a list of age ranges with 92.3% of the vote. Overwhelmingly the winner it was never, or that unfortunate NRA reference that I made last week.
I think that's what attracted people to it.
American Pride.
And then someone did end up voting for the 65 plus category. So when you are a senior, you're too old to be playing video games. So I don't know if maybe this person plays a lot of multiplayer games and they don't want old people playing with them because they'll drag down the team.
No, it could be. Really sure. Alternatively, that by that point, you might have some kind of less flexible joints, so it would physically be less appropriate to play games.
Yeah, yeah. So so we do have that. And then I think I referenced what I was going to do for a poll earlier. So I'll either do that or I'll come up with something new. And we have been dragging on a little bit, so I think we're going to end it here. But we did have a question this week, and we were going to try and work it into the show as the topic, but I think we'll stick it in next week. That sound good to you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So
I think if you want to save time, just cut one of the audio tracks. Flip a coin and cut one of your audio tracks.
Huh? Oh. Well, anyways, so we were thinking of going with this, and we'll probably do it next week. So Plinkett ended up, he was talking about VR, and he said, so just me being me, you brought up VR, I've got one and love it. Do you guys think it has a potential to dominate gaming, such as with the news of Skyrim VR? So I think we might end up using that next week.
Cool. Let's do it.
But yeah. But we did have a couple of people. High Ed made a joke about prying ice cream from his really cold dead hands if the government tried to take that away from him, which I have to agree, ice cream is one of my favorite things, and it's like that's one of those things where it instantly I think makes you a kid. So it's like when you're old you need to have ice cream, right? Like it keeps you young.
Yeah.
And then our own Dave Kinetic, he said that I'd say you're too old. You're only too old for it when you can't physically do it anymore. Which is pretty much the category that I think I...
I mean, that counts for so much, doesn't it, at that age? Not least of which is gaming, but probably other activities as well.
Yeah, pretty much. I'm hoping that by the time I get to that age, we'll have enough gamers at that age that there will be ways around that. We'll have enough money to be able to just, like, force people to find ways to let us play.
So. Oh, yeah. I mean, all the care homes and things have got to have super fast broadband and multiple connections. And
Of course. Yeah. Absolutely.
And forget all those board games and that. No, it's like PlayStation Pros and...
I'll be in a home, and my kids and my grandkids will never visit me because I'm old, and who wants to spend all their time around old people? And so I'll just be sitting there playing video games, and I'll be fine. Like, I'll be all about that. I'll be like, hey, it's okay. Don't worry about it. You don't need to come this week. I got five new games that I can play this weekend. I probably won't even be done by the time you visit next week. So
yeah, just go and see your continuous in progress luck.
Yeah, right. One day I will finish all of the video games.
You'll finish starting all of the video games at the end of that.
Yeah, exactly. My completion percentage will continue to plummet. It'll be rounded to 0%. All right. So I think that's going to be it for us this week.
Before we wrap up, breaking news. Oh. Breaking news coming in.
Okay.
Get the news ticker going, breaking news. But, We've got some news for the site news. There's a site update log and gaming session improvements.
Yes. Yay!
Breaking.
Oh, yeah. Yep, so you can go check that out. I did read that. It is kind of interesting. So basically, they've started posting the site updates, and so you can go back and look at the log of all the various updates that have been made to the site. And I think this one's pretty awesome. There's also, you can clone gaming sessions now.
Attack
of the Clones.
I've been waiting like 3 years for that. So
I've been waiting over 5 years because I was the one that was setting up all the boosting sessions for Seriously for Gears of War back in the day.
Oh, boy. And
so you would set up, like, at the time I didn't have a job and I was just like killing time. I didn't have any money for games, so I was like, eh, sure, why not? I'm going to get this achievement. And so basically what you did is, like, you made a session 10 a.m. on Monday, and then 10 a.m. on Tuesday, and then 10 a.m. on Wednesday. And it was just like, you'd end up making, like, so many sessions for that game. And
not anymore.
It was all identical. But now you can clone them, so you can copy all of the details except for when you want it to be and the participants. So that way you can just copy and paste.
There you go.
So it is a good time to be getting...
Yes, come on. Let's fill up TT with tons of gaming sessions. Just go for it, people.
Yeah. And I'm sorry.
I think that player has multiplayer, so...
Oh, yeah. Yeah, I guess it does, doesn't it? So, okay. So just in time for next week. So maybe we'll see about getting into that game and see what that's all about, and we can set up some boosting sessions.
And people should do, like, super hot VR, like, group sessions.
I mean, and that's the other thing, is you can use group sessions. You don't have to necessarily be boosting. I do know people have set that up just, you know, oh, yeah, I'm going to be playing a game and it's going to be boring, so why don't we party up and do boring stuff together?
Nice.
So that's also a potential use for it. But anyways, thanks for joining us this week. We will see you next week. Remember, you can subscribe on YouTube, on iTunes, on Google Play. You can follow us on the site. You can subscribe and it'll update you whenever there's a new episode. You can follow us on Twitter at True Trophies. I'm Megabrand Zero. Ace is Ace Solo McLeod. Be sure to follow us. And then, of course, remember, go to the site and do the poll and give us feedback on the site. Until next time, thanks for joining us and have fun. We'll see you soon. Bye.
See you around.
See ya.